Let's have a look now at our objects, which are basically the memory locations of our variables and their types, and they are represented in our symbol table, as we said. So the symbol table includes information about each identifier, like myvar1 is an identifier. It includes the memory address that it is stored. Well, by memory address, I mean an address potentially relative to the stack frame or relative to a library in particular. The compiler creates such a symbol table for each object file in the source code, and the linker then uses this table to resolve references across different source files. Note that internally the compiler keeps a different types of a symbol table as well, which is really needed to build up local variable information too. It looks slightly different, but for the sake of discussion, we can assume that's the way the symbol table looks like, even for local variables. Right, so in terms of the symbol table, when you come and see a function, you need to remember the formal parameter list and the output type. So basically you have to remember the signature, because the compiler has then to check if the function is used, that it matches the declaration, otherwise it issues a warning or an error. Right, so let's talk a bit more about identifiers. So, and the attributes we store with them. So we need the name of the identifier, naturally, the data type, like it was an integer, the size, well, typically in this case 4 bytes if it's an integer, the address in memory, and the specific value if it has been assigned. For instance, if it's a constant, then you get the value immediately. So with the declaration, the compiler knows something about the name, type, and size, but the address and the value is only known when we talk about the definition. Particularly the value, sometimes even with the definition, it may not yet be assigned anything if we talk about a local variable. So there are different identifier attributes that we talk about today. One is the scope, that means when and where in the program you can reference an identifier in that has been declared before. Then the storage class, that means which one determines the storage duration, which is the lifetime, which means how long the values of an identifier exist in memory. And lastly, the linkage, which specifies how compilation units can access identifiers of other compilation units. And to be now a bit more precise, so far we used a lot the term variable, and I used it a bit interchangeably between object and so on. It was not quite clear what we really mean by it. So the compiler converts what we understand as a symbolic variable like x into an address that is used at runtime. Actually, this terminology was inaccurate, but it served its purpose. According to the C standard, there are two definitions relevant. One is the object, which is the region of a data storage in an execution environment, which is the contents then of which can represent values. Okay, so it's for an integer, we have our 4 bytes in our memory region, which represent this particular object, and it also means the way we represent the object as to complement data. Then we have memory location, that's either an object of a scalar type or a sequence of adjacent bit fields, well, that have non-zero width. As we are not using bit fields much, typically a memory location is represented as an object. So that we remember that the declaration of an identifier tells the compiler the type of it, but it does not reserve a storage location. It says here necessarily, because there are cases in which declaration and definition fall together. In this case, the declaration does reserve the storage location as well. When you define a variable or a function, it reserves the space for this object. And like we said, well, if you declare, and sometimes the declaration and definition are identical and overlap. So int x, local variable here, means it is declared and it is defined as well, but it is not assigned a value yet. Right, let's talk about the scope of identifiers. An identifier can mean different entities. So you can have a variable x, and you can have another variable x, or potentially even a function called x, that at different points in your program that all refer to different entities, so to different objects. We talk about our variables. And the scope is determined by the location of the identifier's declaration. And also the scope typically defines the lifetime, albeit we have some modifiers for it. So whenever you leave the scope of an object, the object value becomes invalid. And if it lives on an activation record, like on a function that we remove from the stack, then of course we should not access it anymore. This is important when you store pointers to some local variables. This will lead to invalid code, as we've seen in the tutorial. So in terms of the scopes, there are four scopes available. And as it concerns me, there are two that are relevant for us. One is the block level. So whenever you open or close a block, this opens a new scope. And the second is the file level. Okay, so in a file, that is basically the compilation unit that includes everything that the preprocessor include using this include directive. Note that an object identifier can shadow, that means it hides potentially other identifiers with the same name. Okay. So typically when we talk about the file scope, those objects that live there, they are stored in the object file in the symbol table. So that means they are globally available across compilation units, and the compiler will reserve one memory location for this object or function, regardless how often it is used in different compilation units. So you can have in the symbol table one identifier only once. So theoretically and practically, you cannot have a function called x and a global variable called x at the same time, because that would be a conflict of this type. So again, this only applies now on the global level, on this our file scope. That means as long as you declare a variable inside a block, it will be a local variable, so this is not affected. So now there are two types of linkage to determine how available those kind of functions or variables are. And one is called the externally linked objects. They are available, and any function is by default externally linked. So it means you can use it in any compilation unit. And then we have internally linked objects. That means they are only available within the compilation unit in which their declaration or definition appear. And there are now a couple of scope rules involved in this process. And well, let's get started with the function prototype scope, which is very easy. When you declare a function but not define, you know, the behavior of the function, so no implementation is given, then you can basically use identifier and you can use any name, and basically the compiler will ignore them, because only thing that counts for it is the signature of a function. So it knows now func does not return any type, and it has two ints as arguments. But the rule that applies is that you should not name two, or you cannot name two arguments to be with the same identifier, right? So A is not B, makes sense. So now in a block scope, we can have a function, we know that, where we start a function basically opens directly a block, so it is also a block scope where we can add a declaration, and in this case also the definition of a variable, and we can also nest additional blocks. And what will happen is that in any block that we open, once the block ends basically, the variables inside become invalid and you cannot access them anymore. The compiler will ensure this by basically not allowing you to access here in this case D inside that is inside this block, outside of this block. Also note that those blocks shadow, that means they hide variables. So in this case we had a formal argument A, but inside this block we declare a variable A again and assign some value. That means A inside this block has the value 3 and is this kind of object, while outside we still talk about this argument, formal argument over here. Okay, be sure this variable hiding, shadowing, can lead to a lot of unexpected behavior. So in the block scope, you can theoretically also define a variable, which are then locally accessed functions. Such a function can only be used inside of the block that is defined. So here we see we have a function sqr. And so the symbol sqr is not accessible outside of function. It's actually not advised to use this. It works generally with the compilers, but this concept is generally widely available, because that's why I wanted to show it to you. Many programming languages know this concept of nested function, where you can create inside a function another function that is only kind of a support to ease writing and simplify the reuse. Okay, so this declaration here, sqr, shadows any other global identifier with the same name again.